Hello friends, in this particular video we will be discussing about Indian polity and constitution. We'll start with historical evolution, then we'll talk about the constitutional assembly, then we'll talk about salient feature, and moving forward we'll talk about the sources from where the constitution of India have been, various sources for the Indian constitution, and then we'll talk about the criticism that are associated with Indian constitution. So starting with historical evolution first, at the same time you also can write the notes. We'll start with the British. They came in India in 1600 as a trader under East India Company, which had the exclusive right of trading in India under a charter granted by Queen Elizabeth I. Queen Elizabeth I. So they had the exclusive right to trading. In 1765, after the Treaty of Allahabad, East India Company obtained Diwani right. Diwani rights, that is rights over revenue and civil justice. Revenue and civil justice of Bengal, Bihar and Odisha. Of Bengal, Bihar and Odisha. This led to its career as territorial power. This led to their career as territorial power. In 1858, after Sepoy Mutiny, the British Crown assumed direct responsibility for the governance of India. So here, British Crown will direct assume responsibility of governance of India, and its rule continued until India was granted independence on August 15, 1947. These events had greatly influenced our constitution as well as polity. So such event have influenced the various constitution as well as polity. They are explained here in chronological order. So we'll talk about the chronology. So we'll divide it into two part, that is the company rule and the crown rule. The company rule will broadly start from 1773 to 1858 and from 1858 to 1947. These two form, the first will come in under company's rule and the second, that is 1858 to 1947, will come under company crown's rule. During the company rule, so now we'll start with the company rule. Okay, so during company rule, that is 1773 to 1858, numerous acts were passed by British Parliament to regulate the affairs, that is commercial, revenue and military. Commercial, revenue and military of East India Company in India. However, Government of India Act 1935 under the Crown Rule became the main source of our constitution. So Government of India Act 1935, this became the main source for Indian constitution. So we'll start with our first act, that is Regulating Act. Of 1773. So what were the highlights of this particular act? So this was the first step taken by British government टू कंट्रोल एंड रेगुलेट द अफेयर्स ऑफ ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी इन इंडिया. सो दिस वॉज द फर्स्ट स्टेप राइट दैट ब्रिटिश गवर्नमेंट टुक इन ऑर्डर टू कंट्रोल एंड रेगुलेट ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी इन इंडिया. इट रिकॉग्नाइज्ड फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम पॉलिटिकल एंड एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव फंक्शन ऑफ कंपनी. सो पॉलिटिकल एंड एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव फंक्शंस वेयर फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम रिकॉग्नाइज्ड एंड इट लेड द फाउंडेशन ऑफ सेंट्रल एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन इंडिया. सो फाउंडेशन ऑफ सेंट्रल एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन इन इंडिया. नाउ वी विल टॉक अबाउट सम ऑफ द फीचर्स विच आर एसोसिएटेड विद रेगुलेटिंग एक्ट ऑफ 1773. सो फर्स्ट द गवर्नर ऑफ बंगाल वॉज एलिवेटेड टू गवर्नर जनरल ऑफ बंगाल एंड द फर्स्ट सच वॉज लॉर्ड वरन हेस्टिंग्स. ही बिकम द फर्स्ट गवर्नर जनरल ऑफ बंगाल. सेकेंड वॉज दैट इट क्रिएटेड एग्जीक्यूटिव काउंसिल ऑफ 4 मेंबर. एग्जीक्यूटिव काउंसिल ऑफ 4 members to assist him in discharge of his duty. And Governor of Madras and Bombay. So Governor of Madras and Governor of Bombay were subordinated. These presidencies were made subordinate to Governor General of Bengal. So he was given more powerful than both of them. Then it also provide for establishment of Supreme Court at Calcutta. So establishment of Supreme Court at Calcutta 1774. Here there were one Chief Justice and 3 other judges. So the constitution of this was like one CJI plus 3 other. Moving forward, it prohibited the company's servant from engaging in private trade. So prohibited private trade of employee or servants. So it provided the company's servant from engaging in any private trade or accepting present or bribes from native. It strengthened the control of British government over the company. So it also strengthened control of British government over company by mandating the court of directors to report on the company's revenue, civil and military matter in India. Moving forward, we will talk about Pitt's India Act now. Pitt's India Act of 1784. Pitt was the Prime Minister of that time. In order to rectify the defects of Regulating Act 1773, the British Parliament passed an amending Act of 1781, and in 1784 Pitt's India Act was passed. It was also known as Act of Settlement. So if anything comes relating to Act of Settlement, this is nothing but 1784's Pitt's India Act. The act was significant for following reasons. The first was company's territory in India were for the first time called as British possession in India. So they for the first time they said it's British possession in India. Second, the British government was given supreme control over company. So British government was given supreme control over companies' affairs and administration in India. Now we'll talk about some of the features okay so the first was it distinguished between political and commercial function of company so first it distinguished between political and commercial functions of the company I hope you are writing second it allowed the court of director it allows allowed the court of director to manage the commercial affair so court of director will manage commercial affairs and board of control they created new body for political affair thus is it established a system of double government so if a question comes that in what act or in which act there was a distinction between political and commercial function of company it will be Pitt's India Act if or act of settlement or they can ask that in from which act this double government started so it will be Pitt's India Act it empowered board of control to supervise and direct all the operation of military and civil government or revenues of British possession in India now we will talk about the next act which is Charter Act of 1833 so here we'll talk about Charter Act of 1833 This act was the final step towards centralization in British India the features of act it made Governor General of Bengal as Governor General of India so Governor General of Bengal became Governor General of India and vested him all civil and military power therefore this act of for the first time created government of India having authority over entire territorial area possessed by British India so there was first time created government of India all over the territory of possessed by British so first governor general of India was Lord William Bentinck It deprived governor of Bombay and Madras of their legislative power and therefore leading to extreme centralization so governor of Bombay and governor of Madras were deprived of their legislative power and now here was extreme centralization which was started here the governor general of India was given exclusive legislative power to govern entire British India the law made under previous acts were called as regulation while laws made under this act were called as acts it ended all the commercial activities of British East India Company it ended all the commercial activities so here all commercial activity were ended and it became purely an administrative so it purely became administrative body we're talking about East India Company this act in the sense Charter Act of 1833 this act attempted to introduce a open competitive system for the selection of civil servant However, this provision was neglected after several opposition from court of director. So, this was basically introduced, but this was neglected due to the opposition of court of director. Moving forward, we'll discuss the last of this row, that is Charter Act. ऑफ 1853, चार्टर एक्ट ऑफ 1853. दिस वॉज द लास्ट अमॉन्ग द सीरीज ऑफ द चार्टर एक्ट पास्ड बाय ब्रिटिश पार्लियामेंट बिटवीन 1773 टू 1858. फीचर ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर एक्ट विल टॉक विल डायरेक्टली स्टार्ट. इट सेपरेटेड द लेजिस्लेटिव एंड एग्जीक्यूटिव फंक्शन ऑफ गवर्नर जनरल्स काउंसिल. सो इट सेपरेटेड लेजिस्लेटिव एंड एग्जीक्यूटिव फंक्शंस ऑफ गवर्नर जनरल्स काउंसिल. ऑल्सो इट प्रोवाइडेड फॉर एडिशनल सिक्स न्यू मेंबर. सो सिक्स न्यू मेंबर्स एज लेजिस्लेटिव काउंसिलर्स टू द काउंसिल वेर एडेड. देयरफॉर इट एस्टैब्लिश्ड अ सेपरेट गवर्नर जनरल्स लेजिस्लेटिव काउंसिल विच केम टू बी नोन एज इंडियन लेजिस्लेटिव काउंसिल. इंडियन लेजिस्लेटिव काउंसिल. सो इंडियन लेजिस्लेटिव काउंसिल वॉज एस्टैब्लिश्ड अंडर चार्टर एक्ट ऑफ 1853. दिस लेजिस्लेटिव विंग ऑफ द काउंसिल फंक्शन एज अ मिनी पार्लियामेंट adopting the procedures similar to that of British Parliament. For the first time, legislation was treated as a special function of the government, requiring special machinery and special process. It introduced an open competition system. So, open competition system, open competition system of selection and recruitment of civil servant was started under this act. The civil service was thus open to all Indians also. The Macaulay Committee on Indian Civil Services was appointed in the year 1854. So Macaulay Committee on Indian Civil Service was appointed in the year 1854, and according to this act, it extended the rule of East India Company over Indian territory and allowed it to retain their possession on the trust of British Crown. For the first time, it introduced local representation in Indian Legislative Council. So, first time there is a local representation. So for the first time, local representation came into picture, and out of the six new legislative member, four were appointed by local or provincial government of Bombay, Madras, Bengal and Agra. So here of six, four were from Bombay, Madras, Agra and Bengal. The next acts that we'll be studying, that is Government of India Act 1858 and onwards till 1947 independence, we will be dealing with it in the next class. Thank you for watching. Have a great day.